It's really nice to see all your smiling faces and to hear all of your stories. And my story is that my life is like a book, and it's an absolute thrill to keep writing new chapters and ending previous chapters on the right note. And when that chapter is full, and any chapter when it's being written should never be prolonged for the sake of filling in more pages. And that's the way I've tried to live my life, so that when something is done and done, you know, we have to move on. The nature of our existence here on planet Earth is one of change. And if we resist change, then we cease to grow. And I learned this a long time ago, and I've tried everything in every way to try and stick to those ideas and make my major and small decisions on those kind of principles. And I'm glad to say that it appears to work for me. And the same principles were the same kind of things that I applied to the music when I finally got a band that was successful and gave me the opportunity to put to the test all of the things that I'd learned when I was a kid and all of the things that I'd heard when I was a kid about music and sound and the properties therein, like music can soothe the savage beast, music can heal, music crosses all barriers, all of those kind of things. And I thought, well, if ever I get the chance, I'm going to give this a shot. You know, I'm going to see if this stuff really works. And so after being very quiet for 18 years or so, doing what you've all been doing, exactly the same things, I consider that I've actually been living to each single one of you next door, in the house next door. And while you were washing your car on Saturday morning, I was washing mine, and I used to see every one of you putting out the garbage Friday mornings, taking the kids to school Monday through Friday, picking them up, doing all of those things that we all do, you know. And now, you know, all my sons are as big as I am, and a couple of them are going to be much taller. And it seemed like a really good time now to come back and have some fun again with the music and with you all. And apparently, I think we've done about a dozen in-stores now, something like that. And so we're probably talking a couple of thousand people or something, and or thereabouts. And everyone seems to be agreed that, yes, the experiment worked. It did do some of these wonderful things. It did touch us all in one way or another. It did heal the arm that was aching. It did allow us to sleep when there were nagging problems going on incessantly in our minds. All those wonderful things the vehicle of music also allowed the communication of thought and of thoughts. The whole principle of thinking is the best way to travel, if you like. In its simplest form is that thoughts can spread, and we can all use them, and we can capture them and use them and put them to use. And all of those wonderful things that actually do work for us all in one way or another. So this is really a very interesting time, and I'm really thoroughly enjoying it and meeting you all and discovering for myself, one-on-one with all of you, you know, exactly how you feel about all this. And I think also I was very motivated by the fact that I've been starving for years since John Lennon died for the kind of lyrics and music that I'd come so accustomed to listening to and using as my boost. And George Harrison's work, and in fact the Beatles, all of them, and other people too, but unfortunately not enough almost to count on two hands, who really had something to say and who really seemed to want to contribute in a real way. Yeah. And So we had a little get-together in Las Vegas, and about 150 folks turned up, just as we are here tonight. And I mentioned this this starving pain that I'd been experiencing for the past decade or so. And I asked if everyone else had felt this starving pain, and everybody said,
yes.
What?
Of course.
Yes.
And, you know, so that was just another wonderful confirmation to me that, okay, maybe now the disco thing's over, you know. now the punk thing's over, maybe it might be a time to, you know, to start dabbling again. It's given me a good chance also to distill my own thoughts and work out my own, you know, my own feelings and thoughts about life in general. And so I'm trying to convey things now musically. Although the album that I have right now, you know, Among the Stars, is really it's a little bit of a diary, really, of what I've been doing over the past decade and a half. But it was stuff that was there, and I felt it was valid, and it was nice music, and it had some stories to tell. Not necessarily all cosmic, but you know what? Even putting your kids to bed is a cosmic event. It is in my life. And seeing your kids born is a cosmic event. And so I suppose in a way I had to wait for us all to have some kids. Or if we didn't have some kids, we had some friends who had some kids, and we watched our friends change, and we watched how we all became our mothers and our fathers, you know, and came to the conclusions that we were unable to come to when we were the kids. And I'm going to continue making some music. I've got a lot of things that I want to do. We're going to do this, at least visit most parts of the country. We're going to go into Denver and Colorado, Boulder. We're going to do we'll make a stop in Portland and Seattle. And then we're going to go into the Midwest, four or five states in the Midwest. We'll probably do a quick venture into Texas and into Florida, maybe touch in the Carolinas, and maybe venture into in and about the Apple. About the Apple would be better than in the Apple, personally speaking. But you know, we'll try and get touch a little bit so that we're close enough to anybody who has you know, the motivation to get together, that we can do that. And then I'm going to go back into the studio and do a new album, which I've got partially written. Also, a book that I've got partially written. If you're interested, the album's going to be basically a lot of keyboard washes with some orchestral, small orchestral movements, with a lot of poetry. Pardon me. And the tentative title for that is a play on Joseph Campbell's last book, I believe it was his last book, which was called The Inner Reaches of Outer Space. Well, I'm going to call my book The Outer Reaches, I mean my CD rather, The Outer Reaches of Inner Space. And I want it to be a sort of inner musical journey to hyper-dimensional worlds within us, which is the, you know, the Star Trek always say, space, the final frontier, you know. It really isn't. Inner space is the final frontier. That's the last place we have to go. That's the place we need to return to, because that's where all the answers are, you know. And gosh, we've been told many times, haven't we, how if you feel unhappy, go out and buy something, you know. Then you'll be fine, you know. Are you bored? Turn on the TV and watch OJ, right, you know. And everybody can get to watch OJ and all of that fiasco, you know, while they're changing the Constitution in Washington. And so, you know, all of this outward stuff it's time to let it all go, isn't it? You know, and an interesting thing I read. I've been reading a lot of stuff. I do tend to read a lot. And just certain things stick with me, you know. And one of the things that stuck with me recently was, in a book I was reading, said that the yoga of the West is human relationships. And I found that very stimulating because I thought, well, that's really is true. And if you think about it, the yoga of the East is exactly the opposite. The yoga of the East is, you know, find yourself a guru, get some advice, probably gonna have to pay a bit for it, but get some advice, tithe all of your material goods to the ashram and find a cave and try and figure it all out. And then when you figured it all out, or you think you figured it all out, come back down the hill, no human contact, of course, you know, come back down the hill and then try and live your life without knowing how to conduct a relationship with other human beings. And all of a sudden you're going to be taken in by all of the trappings of materialism and of consumerism because you've not been exposed to it. And all of a sudden this is going to hit you. And there's a very interesting thing that I saw on TV about 3 or 4 weeks ago. I think it was like Dateline or something, one of the better investigative TV shows. And they were doing an interview with Deepak Chopra. I'm sure you've all heard of and seen his books on the Ayurvedic, I think it's called that, healing system. And I thought this was really interesting. Here's a guy who's recently arrived, fairly recently arrived in the Western world with his with his teachings and everything, and I thought it was great. And my kids read some books, and we've all had a good look at them in my family. And they were doing an interview with him, and the gal said to him, "Well, doctor," she said, "why are you living in this $2.8 million home, and which is next to this wonderful clinic?" And she said, "If someone wants to get treatment from you, why does it cost $3,500 a week?" And he turned around to her and he said, "Well, this is the American way, isn't it?" You know? And I thought, hello. You know, here's the guy who's been in the cave, you know, he's done all the things. All of a sudden, he is in there. I mean, he's up to there in material shit, you know. And this guy's now got to start where we started, you know, 40, 50 years ago or whatever, you know. When materialism became so rampant in the 50s with plastic paint, if you will, which is like a, I think was like a signpost of things to come, you know. All of a sudden they found something else to make with oil and not cannabis, you know. And I thought, well, this is really, really interesting because now he's going to have to learn to do what we've all been learning to do all of our lives, which is really fight our way out of this material paper bag, you know. And boy, you know, when any one of us actually punches a hole through this material bag that I call this paper bag of materialism and consumerism, when we actually punch a hole through it and we get through this, and we're going to look back and we're going to say, no, thank you. I know exactly what that is. I don't need that. You know, and you understand it, and because you understand it, you won't have any need of it. Or a need is a very big word. But if you wish to use it for any good purpose, then you'll know exactly how to manipulate it because you'll understand it so well that you know all of the natural laws that, well, there are no laws, but all of the natural energies connected with it, you know, you'll be able to manipulate. So. This is what I see as being, you know, the wonderful thing in that, in a sense, if you look at this, it's like the Western world, for all of its faults and all of its literalisms, is really still the forerunner. And I came to America saying that, you know, America has to lead the way. It's the only chance we've got. My first impression was that, wow, this is great because there's no national barriers. And having lived in Europe and been raised in Europe, it's like national barriers. It's a pain in the butt. Especially on top of class distinction, you know, which we see very little of really in the States, and so my view of America has been changing and changing over the years. Where what I see now is this very wonderfully, it's almost been like a masquerade. It's almost like what appears to be this terrible materialism, this terrible grip on people through fear and consumerism and all of these things, is part of a process that's been going on where we're always looking at everything from the fearful point of view, from the black point of view, you know, I mean the dark point of view, if you like. Where the real truth of it is that we're the ones that are facing up to it. We're the ones who are fighting the dragon, you know, and not running away from it and hiding in the cave. So this gave me a new look on things, and once again gave me a great big shot of enthusiasm in my optimism, you know. And then I read another thing that I found very interesting in another book. One of those things that just immediately struck me once again, and it was a guy who said, you know, the glory of creation was not in its inception, but will be in its culmination. It's like, oh, it was a beautiful thing that it started, but what's it going to be when it's complete? You know, another great thought, another great, what are we doing here kind of thing, you know, how is it we are here kind of thought, you know. And I was really stimulated by that. And there's a couple of other things too. One of them is another book I was reading. I sort of collect all these little things together. I mean, that's what seems to happen to me. I read one little line somewhere and it'll mean a lot, and then around that I can build a whole thing. It's almost like in getting a seed idea for a song, you know. I love you, you love me. I can write a song around that, you know what I mean? It's like a little thought, you know. And so I take these little thoughts and then it seems to work its way into my psyche or whatever. And you know, and it grows like a seed. And this was another one of those. And it was that there are only two things in the universe. One is quantity, and we know that's true, you know. And coupled with that is another thing, and that is nature has no morals. Because life on this planet as we know it, for instance, is life eating life. You know, I mean, there's nothing very moralistic about that, is there really? You know, whether we're eating plants, animals, or what, you know. You know, there's positive proof right there, you know, that nature in of itself cannot be blamed for all of the things that happen. You know, when someone loses someone or something terrible happens, a tree falls in the forest, you know, hits somebody on the head, kills them, the close person to them possibly might blame, if their concept is such, they'll blame someone called God for doing this. Why would you do this to me? Why would you take this person away from me? All of those kind of guilt or blame kind of aspects of it. But you have to realize through this that that nature just doesn't have any morals. We cannot blame nature for anything, you know. And then the other side of that was that the other thing, one was there's only two things in the universe, and first of all things are energy, but one was that there was quantity, which is energy, and then the other thing was consciousness. And on the consciousness side of things, it was morals. And whereas nature was amoral, consciousness has morals, and the only actual beings on this planet that we know of, you know, I mean, dolphins might have something going, we're not quite sure, but we certainly know that we have morals. We're capable of moralistic behavior, thinking, doing, all of those things. So we have two things, we have quantity and quality, and so if we're looking for a how is it we are here answer, then the answer must be that our part in nature, in the universe, is to add quality to the quantity. And when you realize that, you know, we've got this incredible planet here, what must be our job? You know, certainly it could be that our job is to add quality to the quantity and turn this place into what we might want to call planet heaven, you know. What are those kind of concepts? So for me, it's like the simplicity of these ideas has to ring true. And, you know, some of the old sayings like, you know, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. But what I think the old monks kind of scrubbed out there back in the Dark Ages was that you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free, but you're going to be madder in hell when you find out how much we've been deceived, you know, and that we're continually being deceived, and how the tendency towards complicated ideas and methods has been promulgated and seeded in our minds at school, as the schools are doing even now, seeding our children with these stupid ideas that something has to be complicated to be valid. Well, of course, there was a saying that, another one of those sayings that I picked up many, many years ago, which stuck with me and became one of my ultimate favorite sayings, and that was, it was so simple, it evaded them. And that's just something that stuck with me and was all the way through, you know, all the way through my own personal public life, my own access to people through the music and everything. And so I thought, well, you know, this is a really good time for me to come back and be able to put some of this stuff around, scatter some more seed in the fields, you know, and come out and do the have you heard again, you know. Have you heard how simple it all really is? And have you played Imagine lately? And did you go out and buy Plastic Ono Band before Imagine came out and check out the track called God? And some of those great things that Lennon said. Because I really miss him, and I'm sure you all do too. I really miss him because, you know, he was a cutting edge kind of guy. And a chap, a bloke, must remember this. And it seems to me that even though they played Imagine at the United Nations, it didn't do them much good, you know. So it's up to each individual person, and we know that. I mean, even the song that I wrote on The Promise, the first song called Free as a Dove, you know, it simply stated that only you can change the way you are. Only you can find your morning star. And that morning star is really you, the life force within your, you know, your own being. And another nice thing I read recently too, and that was that the distance between that you have traveled from your soul to your current character or personality is the amount of pain that you're suffering because of the suffering is the measure of suffering that we all bear is equal or tantamount to the distance that we have traveled away from our soul. You know, our axis bold as love, right? That pivotal point, you know, where the action's really taking place on its deepest, finest level, you know. And so I think this is a good thing. I'm still full of optimism. I've talked to a lot of people. People always come up with the, well, you know, I think if the, and I say, you know, that I think it's inevitable that the large corporate world eventually has to crumble from sheer greed, the weight of the greed that is upon the corporations now. You know, I think it's inevitable because change is inevitable, as we started off talking about. Well, I started talking about. Nobody said anything yet, but it really is inevitable because change is something that you cannot deny. It's a little bit like, you know, all of these people who say, oh, there's no such thing as a new age and things like that. You know, well, sorry, but this is an astrological and astronomical and scientific fact that, you know, our sun is moving into an area in the sky called by the Sumerians and the Akkadians and the Babylonians and the Egyptians and everybody else, Aquarius. You know, and people tend to think of this as being some kind of abstract channeling kind of stick a crystal in your left ear kind of situation, you know. And it's not, it's a scientific fact. And as a friend of mine in New Jersey says, you know, if, as much as you might deny that Tuesday is going to come on Monday, you know, Tuesday is going to come whether you like it or not. And it's the same on that larger scale that, you know, the fact that the sun, our solar system, is going to move into that area you know, and this whole thing is going to happen scientifically, astronomically, it's going to happen. You know, why buck it? Why fight it? It is going to happen. And it's the kind of blind thinking, you know, that we all have to overcome. And so back to the individual thing, you know, all we need is ourselves. All we need is love. And first of all, to have love, and we have to have understanding. And to have understanding, we have to have, first of all, understanding about ourselves, how we work, what makes us tick. You know, how many times do you watch yourself get angry with your kids or your spouse or your best friend, and all of a sudden you're sort of standing there and there's this part of you maybe screaming because something might have happened, or I mean screaming in some form of anger or whatever, and you're sort of up here watching this person, which is supposed to be you, going, no, why the heck did you do that, you know, those kind of things, and all the time you're watching it going, who is that guy, you know, who is that person? That's self-observation. That's what we've been told to do, you know, by all of the great men this world's ever known. And, you know thyself, observe thyself, self-realization, all of these things, it all means the same thing. Start looking at yourself, you know, and then we come to realize, you know, the mechanicalness that Gurdjieff talked about, Uspensky, those guys. Who talked about how mechanical we are and that everything we do is a reaction. Our daily lives are one of reacting to some other kind of stimulus. It's never, very little of our waking time is like made of an action that has come from that axis bolt of as love within us, from that soul point, from that the real you, you know. How much more of it is because someone's pressing your buttons? Whatever it is, something that happened in your childhood, you're still reacting to it. When someone says that certain word to you, that someone way, way back psychologically now triggers this emotion. And most of our problems are emotional anyway. And so it really helps us to look at ourselves that way. It helps us to see that when I, in the mid 80s, I really got into the PC, you know, the home computer thing, like about 1981 when the first ones came out, and I got hooked up with Atari and did a few things with them, a few commercials and stuff, and I did a few talks at some of their Atari fests, and one of the things that I was saying then was that I think this is really a good thing, not only technologically, but it's all of a sudden we have a new way of looking at ourselves because of the PC. Pardon me. What was that I was drinking earlier? And I thought, and the reason that I said that was this, was that I saw how we now had something that was analogous to us that we could use, you know, as a tool to look at ourselves in a different light. And to be able to translate some of the things that Gurdjieff talked about with these, or the other centers that all work independently within our everyday life, within our being, if you like. And it really comes down to that, you know, think about this, that, you know, we have the intellect, we have the emotions, we have the motor controls, I'm gonna blink, you know, I'm gonna do all of these things. There's also, what Gurdjieff called higher emotional center, which means that, you know, that really the more of the spiritual, what we would call the spiritual center, or the higher consciousness, or the right side of the brain, or the you know, where the better brain waves are generated and open up, you know, the right side of the brain, which would be the would be delta, theta, alpha, those kind of brain waves. And what I thought about was, well, this is really very interesting, because if you think about, everybody knows more or less about the IBM series of computers, right? You know, 286, 386, 486, Pentiums, all that stuff, right? Well, the way I sort of tied this together, it was back a little way, so I didn't have those to go with, but I've sort of updated it a little bit. But I thought, you know, this is really interesting. First of all, our motor center, the part of us that operates all of this mechanical movements and all of the things that to do with that and digestion and all these automatic things, heartbeats and everything else, is probably moves like a 286. You know, it's pretty sluggish, but it gets the job done. It's a workhorse, you know, keeps going. But then we've got the intellect, you know, the mental capability. And that is probably running, let's say, a 386, faster, you know. And that's all, how fast we can think, how fast we can react, you know, from the visual stimuli and things like that. But when you think about it, and I think you'll all agree immediately, that the fastest center that we know about is our emotions. And that the computer running our emotions is easily a Pentium. Easily. You know, with the best hard drive, the big screen, everything, you know, all the best, the $3,000 model, you know what I mean? When you think about it, you know, how fast you react with your emotions, so much faster than you can think. So much faster than you can think. And so this is a really interesting situation, because what Gurdjieff was talking about, for instance, was that is that we've got all these various centers, but they're so mixed up because we don't know about them, because we don't realize that they're there, and that we think that we're in control of ourselves all the time, when all along these different centers are operating the whole works. It's like the you know, the workers in the shop, in the factory, are running the factory, and the management thinks they're running it, but they're not, you know. And so it's really interesting from this point of view that what Gurdjieff was saying is that, you know, sometimes that very fast emotional center, that Pentium, will, if it's got nothing to do, it'll start running the intellect side, or it'll start running your motor side, or any of the other kind of series of actions that are happening within us. And all of a sudden, you've got these various things all taken over. Or the computer, the 286 is trying to do the job of the emotions, or, in other words, the complete mix-up of there's no management, yet there's all of these workers all doing these different jobs, all skilled at certain levels, and who start doing jobs that they're not skilled at, and henceforth we have a kind of civilization that we have now, you know, which is, you know, all kinds of strange, weird people doing very strange and weird things, you know, and then we've got some strange and weird people who are doing some wonderful things, you know. But it's a very interesting thing to me, once again, that it's something that's very simple, and it's like we have to look at ourselves as machines. And we can only stop being machines and reacting to all of this stuff when we start acting, and we can only start acting when we start understanding ourselves and how we work. And so I suppose that's what, you know, all the great men in this world's ever known were trying to tell us. You know thyself. Know how you work. Figure out what's going on in there. But you know, how much time do we get to look in there? You know, unless it's on our agenda, unless it's on, you know, a note on the fridge door, you know, something to keep reminding us that we need to do this, you know, every day, as often as possible, so that when we're doing these certain acts and things that we're doing in our everyday life, we can start saying, oh, I know what's going on. I know which part of me is operating that. Well, when something's happening a little strange, you know, you're angry or something like that, and you are looking, and you're sort of standing halfway back here, looking at yourself being, you know, stupid, as we all do, you know, then we can say, okay, I recognize it. And that every chance you get, and this is what they were talking about, every chance you get to recognize that that particular center is now running the show, but you're now back there watching it so you can observe it, self-observation, every time it happens, you're that little bit further, closer to taking over control of the factory again, or the machine. And once we can get control back of our lives, and of our bodies, of our minds, our hearts, all of our emotions, all of those things, then we'll be able to translate all of that, you know, to put the Pentium as running our anger and all of those kinds of things, and our reactions can be then, you know, hooked into the big power drive, actually, sorry, wrong side, the big power drive up here, you know, and we can start running and having, you know, the counselor, the wise counselor lives up here, okay? You know, we've got 12 segments of the brain, you know, the 12 gates, the 12 disciples, anything you want to call them, the 24 elders about the throne. It's all brain, everything's psychological, everything's, you know, all within us, everything's a psychological situation, and we have to get rid of all of these old age notions, you know, of people on clouds playing harps, and that the reason for everything is for some guy out there who just can't wait to come down and kill 3 or 4 billion of us for kicks, you know, and some guy who gets his kicks by killing his son, you know, one way or another. I mean, all these stupid ideas we have to, that we really do have to get rid of, because life is just a simple game. And even though I said it myself way back then, I've come to understand it even more, each day that we go on. And so I'm just happy to get the opportunity to spread it, you know, and that you're interested enough, come and listen to me go on about my favorite pastime, if you like, you know. I don't know how the 49ers did tonight, or what's happening with OJ, because that's not what is important to me. What is important is that we wake up and start realizing that we don't need anything outside of ourselves. We don't need any other person to do this for us. We all have the power to do it ourselves. We don't need a guru. We don't need the reason we had the Dark Ages was because the only people who could read were royalty and the clergy, the monks. So they could tell us anything they wanted to tell us. You know, that's why we ended up with the Dark Ages. That's why we ended up with the Spanish Inquisition, you know, and all of those stupid things that were done in the name of, you know, these organizations. And so let's cut it loose and realize that all we need is each other, you know, to help each other and to say that, you know, I am you and you are me and we are here all together. Because that's what he was talking about, you know.
That's what Mr. London was talking about, I gotta tell you.
And I had the pleasure of knowing the man. And got to tell you, some of that stuff that has been written about him, I don't care what these people write about him or what they think they knew or anything else. All I know was the man that I knew and what he was saying. And what he was saying was coming from his soul, coming from his heart, and what he really cared about and what he could see. I'm also very gratified to know that he knew, unfortunately, when he was taken from us. But he knew, and that's without a doubt. He knew how simple it was. I hope you'll join us, and the world will be one. So all we need is each other, and us as an individual, we have to get, you know, past all of these things. We have to help each other through these things and help our friends and do unto others as you would have others do unto you. It's just all of this great simple stuff, but without all of the airy-fairy sales pitch, you know. My friend in New Jersey also says some great things. He says, beware of the old age and beware of the new age. And so, yeah, it has to be somewhere right down the middle, you know. Because, I mean, I must admit, I'm expecting to see Happy Aquarius Day in Hallmark next week, you know. Let's face it, the greatest pusher of traditions is people like Hallmark, you know. They get us to buy all this stuff. And you know what really annoys me as an Englishman, having come to America, been here 20 years now, it's really bugged me, and my wife will confirm this. But I would go to school with the kids occasionally, and we occasionally did things in the class and those kind of things, you know, as we all do. But the thing that really bugged me was that a certain day of the year would come around and they would dress the entire school up in all these stupid little outfits and uniforms, and they put all of this stuff around on the windows and hanging down, and it was called Halloween. And this was like the big deal. And this was like the enlightening moment for our kids, you know. And I would go there and I'd say, you know, what are you doing? I thought there was supposed to be a separation of the devil and the state. <laughs> You know? So a church and state, I mean, one and the same thing. It says so in the Bible. Yeah. It does, true. It really annoyed me that all of a sudden, you know, they don't want to have anything to do with teaching our kids any kind of consciousness or anything that any of the great men that have ever been around said. But they're quite happy to have our kids dress up in these stupid things and do trick-or-treating. I must admit, many times, I was always tempted, and I did do a couple of times when the kids came to the door, they would say trick-or-treat, and I'd always say trick, to see what they would do, you know. Because no one ever said it to them, you know. It was always, okay, here's your bag of stuff, and, you know. But it always annoyed me, and I thought, why why can't they see that if you want to celebrate something, how about us landing on the moon? How about celebrating the fact that we made it 240,000 miles in a dustbin can, you know, a rubbish can, you call it, right? In a rubbish can to the moon, you know, several times. I even had one blow up and we brought it back and, you know, all the miracle of that. Why not celebrate some kind of thing that said how great this nation is, how great the Western world is, how great the planet is, you know, for the ability to do something which has never been done before. It's probably one of the greatest achievements that, you know, that our particular civilization, if we can call it that, has actually done. And it's not really celebrated other than by TV, you know, but to get some ratings for that week. It always boggled my mind, you know, this is supposed to be the great place to be with the greatest educational system in the world, and they celebrate Halloween. And in England, no one celebrates Halloween, and that's where it all took place, you know, Stonehenge and all of that kind of stuff, you know. Just a strange one, just a strange thing. Once again, you know, we should be celebrating the good things that we've done. We should, if we're going to have any traditions at all, and actually, even that's a very debatable question. You know, when you think about, can we go? Well, let's quote a couple of scriptures again that we probably all heard at Sunday school or somewhere. You know, that remember the disciples were hounding Jesus, and they were saying, "Well, where? How do we get to this kingdom of heaven that you keep talking about? How do we get there?" And he said, it's pretty easy. He said, give up everything you own and follow me. And for the past 2,000 years, this has been literally translated as, you know, you got to give up your Porsche. You got to give up your, you know, your oak wheelbarrow. Whatever you consider a material possession, you know, your money, your clothes, your food, your status, your position, all of these things, this is supposed to be stuff that you own, but think about it. Do you really own any of that stuff? Do you own the land your house is on? Do you really own your house? You know when you're going to be gone, somebody else is going to get a mortgage on it. You know, do you really own any of this stuff? Of course you don't. We can't own any of this. There's only two things we can own. One is our thoughts. And the only way we can, he says, well, you know, leave them behind and follow me. So how do you leave your thoughts behind? You meditate. That's what that means. There's only one way you can leave your thoughts, and that's to get it, rise above your thoughts. And you can only rise above your thoughts if you meditate, just for a few minutes each day. You don't need some guy going, oh, I don't know, I've got to do, you've got to sit in this position like this, have three bowlfuls of curry, and do this, and do this for 17 years, and then come and ask me for some more instructions. I mean, it's, you know, we don't need to do that. It's a simple action. You know, it's one of my favorite things, Indian, of course, because we love curry in England. And then the other thing is that the only other thing we actually own are our beliefs. And out of our beliefs, as we just talked about, come our traditions. So he said, what was he saying? He said, meditate. Get rid of all of your beliefs, everything you've ever believed. Get rid of all your traditions that you've been following and you live your lives by, and follow me. It doesn't get any simpler than that, does it? You know, really. And because it's so simple, it must be true. It must be right, if there's such a thing as truth. It must be right. It must be, well, I know one thing, it's better than all of this other stuff that's been forced down our throats, you know. And you know why we're all sitting here? Because we're sick of drinking the old red wine, aren't we? We're sick of drinking the old wine. This is my friend in New Jersey says, I love this guy. We're sick of drinking the old wine. We're sick of the old stories, the old, you know, you've got to do this, you've got to do that, don't annoy anybody in the government, don't annoy, you know, whatever it is. I'm not a political person, and I'm not saying that we have to have a revolution and go out into the streets and hold banners or any of that stuff. We don't have to do any of that, because as it was said in the 60s, the revolution has taken place in the minds and the hearts of the people. And the only kind of revolution that will even work and succeed is the one that takes place within you and me as an individual person, because only you can change the way you are. I can't do anything to change you or you or you or any of you here. You know, I mean, I can talk for hours and hours and hours, but unless you decide that you want to do something about it, I'm not going to do anything, am I? Right? So it's you who decides. Yeah. It's you who decides, and it's me who decides for me. And I decided a long time ago that, you know, I want to keep grabbing hold of this and get and try and find out as much about this as I possibly can, because you know, I read in the 60s and like all this stuff, and it was, you know, Yogananda so and so, and it was all of these, and there was the Sufis, and there was the Hopi Indians, and the Australian guys, and you know, every major thing that I could get into, I got into, and I had a look, and I still came out frustrated. I still really didn't know anything except more and more bulk, you know, more quantity. It was just quantity, quantity, and you had to search through, you know, a bucket full of quantity to get one drop of quality out of all of these people writing the books and all the rest of it, you know. So when we finally add a few drops of quantity together, it sort of has this wonderful, life-giving energy, you know. And I see this energy coming back from you when you come to the in-stores, and we talk about old times, and yeah, you know, what did the music do for you? Well, I got married, 1997. Yeah, our three kids were born to out and in. Have you heard? You know, we hang our memories on the shape of sound. That's what's so special about music. That's why you remember those things, because music is shape and sound, and so it's easy to hang a memory on it, because it's got plenty of storage area. See, music's like a disk drive, if you like. It's got storage. That's why it's so easy, and we can keep it. And you know, you can remember the first song you ever, piece of music that you ever fell in love with. You know, you can remember what was playing when you met your wife. You can remember all of these things because music was present in your life at that time. And it's much harder to remember the things that happened in our lives when music wasn't present, right? You know. So here we've got a wonderful tool, and I just hope that I can spread you know, some goodwill and some information to motivate other people. You know, to look for the right kind of music and try and produce the right kind of music. And you know, we were sitting in a place here where a lot of music is made, and I know that the people, dear old friend, in fact, people I haven't seen for 20 years or more here, and I know they know what this is all about, and you know, that's why they're here in, that's why they're not really living in Los Angeles. They're living in Phoenix because there's a good vibe here. There's some good things happening. There's some good people here. And, you know, that's the way I see things. And that's the way, that's one of the reasons also, of course, that I wanted to do this in my own way. I didn't want to come back and be with a big, what I call the oil record company, you know. The people who make decisions know nothing about music. They don't care about music. They don't care about us. They just care about, you know, got to get some new bumpers on the Porsche. You know, I've got to you know, make sure that I get my $3,000 yearly annual membership at the golf club. You know, they're caught up in in the paper bag. But they think the paper bag is what they're searching for. And of course they're not, so you know, they're they're spoiling it for everybody. blasting, bursting, billowing forth with the with the power of 10 billion butterfly sneezes. Man with his flaming pyre conquers the wayward breezes, climbing to tranquility far above the clouds, rising to conceiving the heavens, clear of misty shroud. Hang on, let me take my pants off.
Hello, I'm Mike Pinder, and I was a singer in a rock and roll band called the Moody Blues. While I continue to make my music, the message remains the same. My audience are now parents, as I am, and have children of their own. And it is to this new generation that I now turn with a series of stories from around the world for the child within us all. I have recently completed a West Coast tour promoting my new CDs, and here are a few highlights. This is the tale of John Jeremy Colton, who lived in a village a few miles from Bolton. The house that he lived in looked out on the green, and it was the strangest the village had seen. From the moment he moved there in June 1920, the changes he made were both startling and plenty. He painted the walls a buttercup yellow, and the thatch on his roof was the hue of lime jello. His windows were red and his door a bright blue. His candy-striped shutters caused quite a to-do, for the townsfolk who lived there, each man and each woman, considered his taste to be almost inhuman. Each day they would stare from their great cheerless houses, clucking and tutting at home with their spouses. For everyone wished that their neighbor would move. Surely he knows that we all disapprove. John Jeremy Colton, if he were aware, seemed not to worry or bother or care. He whistled and sang as he strolled down the street, greeting each person he happened to meet. And thank you for watching.
What do you see as the big difference between doing these children's stories and putting together music for a group like the Moody Blues?
Well, it's very interesting because there's new challenges here for me. And that's what I like. I like a challenge. And as Peter Sellers would have said, a challenge.
Clouseau.
Clouseau, yes. But I think the fact that they're multicultural stories, they're from around, all around the world, they're mythological stories, creation stories, uplifting stories. We looked for hours and hours to find these stories, my wife and I. Now, we would find many stories that were the mouse went down to the rabbit's house for a cup of tea. Or the rabbit went down to the mouse's house for a cup of tea, and we were looking for the mouse went down to the rabbit's house and discussed the zen of tea making. You see, so I'm really trying to create an alternative to the violence of video games and cartoons and the like. And also, these are mythological stories, they're multicultural stories from around the world, and the object being that, you know, we need to lead our children to help lead our children to an adulthood, to maturation.
I recall growing up hearing Eddie Cantor Danny Kaye.
Yes, Danny Kaye.
Folks like that.
Burl Ives.
Yeah, Burl Ives, exactly. Doing the same kind of thing for our generation.
Yes.
How see, valuable it
was. I felt that they'd passed nuggets of wisdom and information to me, and now it was my turn to pass those on and anything else I'd learned along the way to the next generation. And I think a simple way of looking at this also in terms of the spirituality, this is Joseph Campbell for children of all ages.
I realized, you see, when I was four, of the things that impressed me, that story by Jimmy Durante, when in 1968 we made an album called In Search of the Lost Chord, mm-hmm. which was our second
right.
big album, you know. And so I realized that what I'd been affected by as a young child set me on a path to follow in my entire life, and here I am still on it, all because of Jimmy Durante and those guys.
Great.
I think you're talking about breathe deep the gathering gloom, watch lights fade from every room, bedsitter people look back and lament another day's useless energy spent, impassioned lovers wrestle as one, lonely man cries for love and has none, new mother picks up and suckles her son, senior citizens wish they were young. Cold-hearted orb that rules the night, removes the colors from our sight. Red is gray and yellow white, but we decide which is right and which is an illusion. Bong!
How cool was that? How cool was that?
Huh?
Man, drive safely. That's our show. Remember your waitress. You can't finish. You can't follow that.
I've got goosebumps.